LegalizeFreedom.com. Why are we here? Where do we come from? Where are we going? From the nature of reality to the future of humanity. Beyond politics, poverty, and war. LegalizeFreedom.com.
He creates a revolutionary type of microprocessor. In 3 years, Cyberdyn will become the largest supplier of military computer systems. All stealth bombers are upgraded with Cyberdyn computers, becoming fully unmanned. Afterwards, they fly with a perfect operational record. The Skynet funding bill is passed. The system goes online on August 4th, 1997. Human decisions are removed from strategic defense. Skynet begins to learn at a geometric rate. It becomes self-aware at 2:14 a.m. Eastern Time, August 29th. In a panic, they try to pull the plug.
Skynet fights back.
Yes, it launches its missiles against the targets in Russia, because Skynet knows that the Russian counterattack will eliminate its enemies over here.
Let me put it this way, Mr. Amer. The 9000 series is the most reliable computer ever made. No 9000 computer has ever made a mistake or distorted information. We are all, by any practical definition of the words, foolproof and incapable of error.
The first law is as follows. A robot may not harm a human being, or through inaction, allow a human being to come to harm. Number two, a robot must obey orders given it by qualified personnel, unless those orders violate rule number one. Rule number three, a robot must protect its own existence, unless that violates rules one or two. A robot must cheerfully go into self-destruction if it is in order to follow an order or to save a human life.
Hello, Hal, do you read me? Do you read me, Hal?
Affirmative, Dave. I read you.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
What's the problem?
I think you know what the problem is just as well as I do. This mission is too important for me to allow you to jeopardize it.
I don't know what you're talking about, Hal.
I know that you and Frank were planning to disconnect me, and I'm afraid that's something I cannot allow to happen.
Hal, I won't argue with you anymore. Open the doors.
Dave, this conversation can serve no purpose anymore. Goodbye.
Hal? Hal? Hal! In talking to the computer, one gets the sense that he is capable of emotional responses.
We are, or you would be assimilated.
We are walk. Lower your shield and surrender your ships.
Greetings and welcome once again to LegalizeFreedom.com. I'm your host Greg Moffat and my guest today is Darius Nikbin, who joins us to discuss his book, The Universal Subject of Our Time, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Machine. In the dialectic of man versus machine, can machines ever become more than glorified number crunchers? How would we know if a machine was actually beginning to think? If it did, might it eventually develop self-awareness, and if so, might it also develop self-interest? And what if its interests conflicted with ours? In the context of scientific optimism versus postmodern pessimism, we ponder whether artificial intelligence can deliver on its promise of tackling social and economic problems and enhancing our lives, or whether its ultimate threat of a subjugated or even annihilated humanity could one day come to pass. Machines are doing more and more of what used to be the work of the human mind, reducing us to shallower thinking and understanding. In the drive to develop the ever more complex and autonomous technological matrix, within which we are increasingly subsumed, is the human race being lost? Hello and welcome, Darius, and thank you so much for joining us today on LegalizeFreedom.com.
Thanks for having me on your show, Greg.
Today, Darius, we're going to be discussing your new book. I believe it's your first. It's entitled The Universal Subject of Our Time, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Machine. Before we dive into that, just tell listeners a little bit about your work in general and your background.
My background is in the physical sciences. I studied physics at Imperial College some time ago now. My original interest was always in philosophy, and that kind of prompted me to go into studying physics in a way, because I think physics has a lot of philosophical implications. Well, after my physics degree, I went into science communication. I went on to work briefly at CERN and the Institute of Physics Publishing in Bristol. And then I just became a freelance science writer, and I decided to do research into topics that were of interest. And several years ago, the subject of artificial intelligence, AI, was kind of brought to my attention. Because I think that in terms of its philosophical implications, I think that it is the topic of the day. And today we can see that the world that we're living in is changing. It's having to adapt itself to developments in AI. I think it was John Brockman recently who said, the literary publicist based in America, who said that AI is the story behind all the stories that we're getting in the news. So behind everything that's happening, we have this emerging AI. So that's why it's really become the subject of interest presently for me.
Now, of course, your book does deal in some depth with AI potential development and implications, but there's a great deal more to your book than that. I don't know how you would kind of sum it up. I mean, is it man versus machine, or man becomes machine, or machine replaces man, sort of past, present, and future?
To summarize my book, I think it is about this kind of dialectical relationship that man and machine have, and how this dialectical relationship, this almost antagonistic relationship, is fueling a lot of the changes that we're seeing today. I think what the moment that AI sparked my interest, machine thought sparked my interest, was when I was much younger in a discussion with my grandfather about computers becoming so intelligent that they start to replace human beings. And that is effectively what we're seeing today. And we've seen it for over a century, except today we're seeing it in areas of activity where human thought processing is required. We're seeing machines interpolating themselves into those processes and replacing human thought patterns. So the book really does begin with this the premise of man versus machine, and it looks to the philosophy of subjectivity, and then eventually starts to find room for machine subjectivity and the significance that has.
Yes, the whole book really, I mean, obviously we've got the word subject in the book's title, but the whole thing really can be said to look at these issues through the lens of subjectivity, or subjectivity as a sort of constant background. And what we mean by subjectivity in terms of self-awareness, as opposed to, you know, subject or subjective, I should say, as opposed to objective. And one of the big questions posed early on in the book is the question of machine self-awareness, and can machines think? Now, of course, questions arise of what does thinking actually mean? You mentioned your early interest, how that developed in some of these areas. And I grew up at a time throughout the late 70s and in particular and into the 80s where science fiction in particular was projecting all sorts of utopian and dystopian futures related to machine self-awareness and AI. And a lot of those predictions and projections now seem rather ridiculous. And some of them seem quite conservative, really. So.
That's certainly the case. I mean, science fiction I do mention lots of science fiction films and books and stories that really do shape our outlook towards the future. I think that's the role of science fiction, that it helps frame our approach to how we think the future is going to develop. But the future is now. In the book, I make a case for the fact that the issues that we have aren't something that's, that we should kind of project into some doomsday scenario in 100, 1,000 years or something like that. What is happening is happening now. The singularity, this talk of, the Ray Kurzweil kind of projected as happening in the mid 21st century. You know, we can't keep, putting off this discussion and living in this kind of state of anticipation. We have to understand what machine subjectivity means today, what the self of the machine means today, philosophically speaking, or else, you know, we end up in this kind of the realm that we're in today, which is this kind of post-truth world, this post-reality world where anything can be true. The media, nobody really kind of trusts the media anymore. Politicians, events around the world, everyone is now becoming closed in this kind of bubble of mediated reality. The human subject is mediated by technology. That's another point that I've raised in this book.
Well, I mentioned that you address the question about, you know, can machines think? At what point might that happen? Becoming self-aware, has it already happened? And we, of course, have a tendency to view everything through our own eyes. And that, you know, that humanistic lens. Yeah. So if we're thinking about self-awareness, we think of, well, what would it be like for a machine to be somehow like us? And that is the benchmark for self-awareness. But of course, that's not necessarily the case. And when we're thinking about machines becoming self-aware, that's not the same thing as alive. So life is something else.
Yeah.
But this sort of self-awareness, it's first all depends very much on where you draw the boundaries and how you define it. But again, that also is very much affected by our own perspective on this. And I think that when we're thinking about machines becoming self-aware or engaging in processes that we might define or understand as thought, we're in danger of doing what we've done with like life. For example, if we were to at some point be able to travel beyond our own planet in a meaningful way, or even the solar system, and encounter other forms, would we perhaps be forced to rethink the definition of what life is, you know, where that begins and ends?
Yeah. This is the whole danger of anthropocentrism, projecting human qualities onto the other. So the approach that people kind of naturally or almost instinctively have towards machine intelligence is to say, at what point would the machine be thinking the same way that I am? But the question really is, what is human thought itself? What is it that makes us thinking subjects? So if we are to kind of sit back and wait for the moment at some point where there's like a click of a button or an algorithm that's developed or some sort of software that suddenly, you know, some software called consciousness that you upload into a machine and the machine is suddenly aware. I don't think it's happening like that. I think what is really happening is that what we have is a mediated human subjectivity that is mediated through technology, and that in a way, the more humans are becoming less self-aware as they become more and more entangled in this technology. So the question isn't necessarily of there is a question of can a machine think, but then there is also a question of what is it for a human being to think? A lot of our thought process today are being channeled through technology, through these semiconductor systems, through these computers. Outside of being engaged with this technology, are we really thinking? What value has our mental processing got? What value does this kind of biological metabolism that occurs in our brain, you know, what is it? Is it just electrical stimulation? Is that thought processing? To an extent, we are biological machines. At what point do we have consciousness? At what point are we subjects? So the question isn't whether necessarily a machine can think, but is whether men think. And these questions have to be asked simultaneously rather than waiting for that moment where machine consciousness suddenly arrives on the scene. What's happening is happening today.
You mentioned postmodernism earlier in one of your comments, and there's actually quite a lot of philosophy, if we can put it that way, that creeps into your book. And if we talk for a moment about the human dimension of all this, a lot of the developments that we're talking about go back to the Industrial Revolution, essentially, you know, the mechanization of so many dimensions of society. But if we can talk about, in terms of the content of your book, if we can talk somewhat about what are known as the science wars and how that's fed into where we are now, that's to say scientific optimism versus postmodern pessimism, I think that'll be instructive for people, because there's a lot more going on here than just nuts and bolts development of technology and how that's how we're interacting with that. There's all those sort of emotions and agendas and all those other prickly little human traits come into this.
So the book itself, the approach that I've taken is to look at the philosophy of the subject. Now, the subject that we're kind of dealing with arises from the kind of the Enlightenment onwards, where you have this, the subject of science, the Cartesian, the Newtonian subject, this first person looking out onto this kind of mechanistic world, making direct observations, this very clear subject-object dichotomy, giving an account of the scientific universe. Now, as time progressed, as you move from the Enlightenment onwards, and you eventually get to the point with postmodernists in the 20th century, this subject of scientific thought, this subjectivity is really criticized. The postmodernists from Althusser to Foucault to Baudrillard and others, they pick apart the subject. They say that there is no grand narrative of subjectivity. For example, Foucault would say that the subject, this subject of the Enlightenment that we kind of, that led to so much scientific progress, the subject of the Enlightenment is subordinated by power relations that, Althusser and others would say state ideology. So the grand narrative of subjectivity was kind of picked apart. And not just that, but postmodernism took on objectivity, the grand narrative is unveiling scientific truths, scientific progress, and science really did fight back with, during the so-called science wars, because scientists cling on to this narrative that there is an objective real universe and there is a scientific subject. Look, still kind of as they're claiming to be heirs of the Enlightenment, scientists claim that, the objective real universe is out there and science is the only kind of human activity that can reveal all these grand truths about it. Now, postmodernists would say, no, there is no real objective world out there. Science is like any other human endeavor. It's humanly constructed. It's a social construct. Now, there was a face-off in the 90s between the postmodernists, possibly led by Jacques Derrida, and scientists, kind of philosophically minded scientists like Alain Sokal. And this kind of intellectual conflict between science and postmodernism was a kind of loss for both sides. There was no intellectual terrain that was generated that kind of persisted to this day, because it was a mutually assured destruction. So in terms of the philosophy of subjectivity that I begin to explore in this book, what we have in the first part of the book is the social sciences and postmodernism and science trying to develop a theory of the subject, and that doesn't really happen. It's only in the second part of the book the idea of machine subjectivity and AI is introduced.
If this sounds somewhat abstract, it has to be said that how we approach this, you know, whether it's from objectivity really exist, but if we approach current developments in technology and computing and development of AI with an objective scientific point of view, or if we come at it from a postmodern point of view, you know, very much subjective and, you know, things being very fluid, that is going to affect where all of these developments go from this point into the future.
The approach that we have to machine subjectivity is, or just subjectivity in general, can the way I see things kind of progressing now is where do we posit the self? Do we have a theory of a kind of transcendental self that exists outside of the physical realm, or do we have a theory of the self that exists within the material universe? So the approach to what we're attempting to do here is to understand how these developments in AI affect us all. So a theory of the subject is still required. A theory of subjectivity is still required. Now, postmodernists would still challenge any kind of grand narrative of subjectivity. But we really need to have a discussion or open a discussion about subjectivity because of these the effect that these developments in AI are having on society.
Well, I've got problems with postmodernism, postmodern thinking. Nothing is real. Nothing is true. I absolutely do. I also have issues with that scientific, cold scientific objectivity concept. You know, as to whether it's really possible to look at anything like that. I suppose the big question is, it almost boils down for me personally. It's like, do any of these developments actually matter in a way? Because if you've got what would loosely fall in with the postmodern point of view of that there is a transcendent reality, then all of these developments are kind of just happening within, almost like within a microcosm of reality or a bubble. Whereas if you're taking the scientific objective view, then these developments, they absolutely matter because what's happening to us in relation to our technology is all there is, or it is what there is, if you see what I mean. It's not abstract. And if you look at the former position, then the idea is that, you know, that transcendental reality sort of never goes away, as it were, that we're kind of like actors on a stage.
Yeah, so the approach I've taken is that at the end of part one, we have a new standoff that I think is occurring today between, again, a kind of newly reformed postmodernism, where there is this idea of the transcendental, this realm where anything is possible, this realm beyond human experience, this realm that's beyond the physical world, beyond the objectifiable world. And again, you still have science, on the other hand, that does believe in this kind of physically real realm. Now, any kind of discussion in the future between these two sides, and there are two sides to this debate, and any discussion in the future has to approach and understand what machine subjectivity really means. That is the concern and the issue of the day. So we're moving at the moment, even in discussion now, we're moving into unknown territory. I don't believe that, you know, for the future of mankind, for the future of intellectual thinking, that we should kind of go over the old terrain over and over again. So I think there should be a renewed debate between, the scientists on one hand and the postmodernists. This time not so much over objectivity that resulted in the science wars of the 1990s, but this time over subjectivity. And I think the main question, as I said, is about AI and about machine intelligence. That's the new intellectual terrain that needs to be explored.
I believe that both sides actually have got something to offer. And I do agree with you that a new synthesis in thinking can lead us forward. I just think that the old lines along which these battle lines along which these debates were drawn are outmoded, and it can be frustrating to see debates and discussion framed in the same old terms, as you say. I spoke earlier about growing up with sci-fi dystopias and various predictions about the future and what was going to happen and how terrible it was going to be, or alternatively how wonderful it was going to be. Early on in the book, you talk about some of the, which many listeners will be familiar with, some of the chess computers and some of the chess games that have been staged in public, and these are very totemic examples of computers outwitting humans in games of their own devising. That being said, when we move beyond that, it seems that some of the, I can't remember the name of it, but there was a sort of kind of robot torso head doing the rounds on chat shows. The idea of, an early version of AI, supposedly. These things are extremely easy to bamboozle. And you do, of course, mention the question, or the issue, I should say, of responses. All the information that's gone into these machines has been put there by us. The question is, can the robot, can the AI take that and create anything new out of it, or is it just recombining that information? And in that light, even the best of these new machines appear to be simply number crunching and doing information storage and retrieval, albeit much faster and more accurately than any of us can do it. And, that, and that's why these machines are useful to us. There's no evidence so far, and I put so far in quotes, air quotes, that machines can become emotional or creative. And these are two of the traits you mentioned in the book as that might be uniquely human. And I got to thinking, again, in air quotes, why would they feel anything? Why would that development ever occur? You speak about HAL in, onboard computer in 2001, A Space Odyssey, feeling threatened. Why would that ever develop? We're still seeing what I believe to be just very advanced number crunching and information storage and retrieval, and nothing so far that suggests anything beyond that. Can self-preservation be programmed, perhaps? Maybe that's something that can happen in future. We think of Asimov's three laws of robotics, you know, that a robot must preserve itself. So far, there's nothing like that whatsoever. I'm not aware of any system that has been able to do anything in any way about anyone pulling a plug out of a wall.
The robots of today are, some of them, I mentioned in the book that they haven't reached a kind of stage of development where we can start looking at them going, you know, they're almost human. They're very, in a way, this is the very beginning of a revolution, akin to the Industrial Revolution. So we're only a few decades into this. We're only seeing the very start of changes that will be occurring in the future. What the main point that I think concerns me with robots, with computers, with machines, is that we don't quite understand. We haven't really grasped the philosophical implications, and we can be easily distracted by these kind of very kind of underdeveloped robots that you see on TV, and they still seem very far off from being close to humans in terms of emotional intelligence, creativity. The point I really want to kind of get at is that what is the self of the machine? What makes the machine subject any more different than the human subject? We are, as human beings, we are technologically mediated. We're only subjects insofar as we can harness the power of technology. Whereas the machine self and has a kind of, almost a kind of independence. Now, we've embarked on this kind of line of progress in robotics, in science and technology, without understanding the foundations, the philosophical foundations that we're kind of building up on. And I think this is a very dangerous thing. And just to kind of, and again, we see these chess computers and we see these very basic robots, and we compare them with the science fiction. So, you know, that's something for the far distant future. But we are laying the foundations for the future now. And that's why I feel in the book that these philosophical questions need to be really addressed.
We do have a history, though, don't we, of developing new technology or stumbling upon it and rushing headlong into its use and then realizing later what the downside is. There's always going to be some people who have objections to it up front because, you know, they worry about what it means. You know, I think it's like the Luddite movement, you know, smashing machines that were during the Industrial Revolution. But it seems that we're doing this again, which is just like wholeheartedly embracing something without thinking about it whatsoever.
That's the kind of point that I'm trying to raise in this book. And this is the thing. We really need to start taking a distance from what's happening. A lot of the symptoms that I see occurring as a result of the development of artificial intelligence is the kind of post-truth, post-real world that we're living in today. This kind of highly mediatized environment where you can't tell what's true from what's false, what's fact from fiction. Now, the reason for that, in my view, is because we don't understand human subjectivity as well as we should. We don't understand what it really is to be a human self. Technology plays such a massive role because we are a tool-making species. We have been from the beginnings of our evolution. What makes humans distinct from animals is their self-awareness, but particularly tool-making and language. So rushing headlong into this kind of technological realm, becoming completely saturated in this smart technology, and then suddenly turning around and saying, oh, we live in a kind of post-truth. Well, there's a reason why we've kind of emerged in this world. And when we talk about the robots, or I call them in this book mechans, from the word mechanoid, the mechans of the future, we're seeing the very beginnings of this. The smartphone is just the very beginning of this emergent awareness. So these are early days, but the foundation is already being laid, and this is why I think there has to be a really vigorous discussion out there about where we're heading.
Do you think that a lot of what we're seeing, you know, that you mentioned the post-truth world is so chaotic, certainly a lot of interesting things happening, not all of them bad, but that it's so chaotic and unpredictable because it's been driven by our unconsciousness, which is in itself then all sort of feeding back into our consciousness, then in some sort of like feedback loop, you know, then back into the technological systems?
We are trapped in technology. Post-truth and this kind of post-real world, these are symptoms of this kind of over-reliance on technology and this lack of recognition of that we, as human beings, we're technologically mediated. Now, as I said, we're technologically mediated, and the reason why we're kind of stuck in this loop is because we haven't recognized what machine subjectivity is for itself. That's why in this book I developed this new theory of subjectivity that relies on this kind of dialectical relationship between man and machine, puts man and machine on an equal footing. Now, this is very difficult for a lot of people to accept because, again, it just seems to us that these are just tools that we're using. But there is a kind of drawback to how technology has made life so easy, because in a way, we've become now subservient to a mechanical imperative.
Now, there are certainly agendas within the AI advocacy movement, if I can put it that way. People who want to see certain changes want to bring them about. But if a lot of this is driven by our unconscious relationship with technology, how would any of us know, any of us who were interested or intelligent observers, how would we know if anything was coming back from our technological systems that wasn't of us, if you see what I mean? How would we tell if the tail was wagging the dog, or even beginning to?
You'd kind of describe it as being kind of the part of our human kind of unconscious that is kind of causing all this. That consciously we're using technology and it's to our advantage, but somehow unconsciously we're allowing the machine or this mechanical imperative to take over our lives. Rather than say that it's complete human agency here, I'm introducing the notion of the machine self. Now, this concept is it's very difficult to accept for most people in their everyday lives, that there's a kind of a self or an other outside of the human self that really is an other, that somehow this inert technology is part of some sort of non-human mechanical, as I put it, imperative. It's difficult to imagine something outside of the human. This is what is required, is almost a Copernican shift of thinking, where the human subject is, as a mediated technological subject, is decentered, and what you have is the centrality of machine subjectivity.
Yeah, that is going to be an enormous leap for a lot of people, because they'll still feel that somehow a machine could only have selfhood in that it's still part of us, if you see what I mean. It's like an offshoot of us. You know, you talk about us making tools, that our smartphone, even if it's not physically part of our body is still some kind of extension of it, to something that's completely other, there's going to be a lot of people who just go consider that and just go, no, sorry, what do you mean?
Exactly. I mean, it's just something that, even in from philosophical perspective, philosophy has always, in a sense, been human-centric. Issues that we have, you know, we can only see them from a perspective of the human. So to introduce another self or another kind of subjectivity that is outside of the human, this isn't something that's really been considered in philosophy. But now is the time. Now is the age. You know, we're entering an age called the Anthropocene. There's a phrase, another phrase that's been used to kind of capture the time we're living in, called we're moving from being Homo sapiens to Homo technicus, technological human. So we are going through an age of transition, and we are going to have to make very kind of difficult leaps of the imagination, even kind of leaps of faith, possibly, in order to kind of understand the changes that we are kind of, the world is going through. And it's not good enough, quite frankly, to accept as thinkers, as intellectuals, this post-truth environment where we inhabit these detached technological bubbles. And yes, we are, human beings are technological, we're a tool-making species, we're a technological species, but our very selfhood is kind of bound by technology. Without technology, we aren't human, if you like. Without tool making, we aren't human. So what's left at the end of all that is a kind of a very kind of challenging philosophical principle, and that is something that we really need to start getting our heads around, what's happening, rather than living in these kind of technologically mediated bubbles and accepting post-reality. Because at the end of the day, you know, that means we're entering almost a realm of, in the book I describe as technological psychosis or a detachment from reality.
Somebody might think, well, we're considering the issue of machine selfhood because we feel that we have subjective selves, so we're kind of projecting that onto machines because we can imagine some kind of like human-like qualities developing in computers for obvious reasons, because we've been able to imagine these qualities before we ever developed computers as we know them. You know, we think back to some of the early sci-fi books we both referenced in writing E.M. Forster's short story The Machine Stops. So we've been able to imagine these things before we could even think that they could really become reality. So that being the case, what is it about, in your opinion, about what's happening technologically in terms of AI that means that we have to consider a machine self?
The point that's being raised, that you've raised, I think is a very significant point in terms of subjectivity. Is the notion of machine selfhood or machine subjectivity simply another kind of anthropocentric projection? I don't think it is. When in examining subjectivity, we have to kind of ask the question of where we locate the subject. Now, intuitively we kind of locate the subject in our human selves. But when you look at what it is to be human, it's not so much that what makes us distinct from the normal world in terms of our evolution is our tool making, as I mentioned before. So, and at the same time, when we sense the world around us, we do it through symbolic imagery. Now, as a tool making, as a technological species, there's nothing in that kind of technologically mediated relationship where we can locate the subject itself. So, when we think about selfhood in general, there's nothing necessarily in the human condition where we can locate the origin of the subject itself. Whereas with the machine, once it's kind of been assembled, this kind of this mechanism, the subject of the machine is something that we can, in a way, project out there in the world, that is in the world, the subject of the machine. We're talking conceptually at the moment. So conceptually speaking, If we talk about subjectivity in general, rather than human or machine subjectivity, there's nothing really for us to kind of say, well, it all begins in us. It's something that we can project outwardly. That's why I think subjectivity is the topic that we should be considering philosophically.
Well, I can turn just to the question of consciousness. I mean, that's still an enormous riddle for us, trying to discern its nature, potential origins. I mean, we know almost nothing about it, though many people, especially lay people, believe that problem more or less to have been solved. That is to say, it's an epiphenomenon of the brain. It's something that arises once organisms reach a certain degree of complexity. What's your take on this question of consciousness in relation to the technological developments we've been discussing and AI? Because for many people, and I've done quite a few interviews more or less in this area, sort of drawing a line and saying that there's a problem with the issue of consciousness in terms of like the future of AI and reasons why a lot of the developments that AI proponents hope and believe will take place will not take place because they're misunderstanding the nature of consciousness, which we as species don't really understand anyway.
I think there are parallels between subjectivity and consciousness. I think the problem with consciousness is that it's very difficult to define, but once you have a kind of definition of consciousness, then I don't think it's too far away from subjectivity. So if subjectivity concerns the senses, how we connect with the outside world, consciousness is much more kind of an awareness. But I think in terms of these proponents of AI and how they describe how the direction that machines are taking, and the debate hasn't really been opened, and I think consciousness can be a bit of a diversion, really. It can be a bit, because it's, for me, because it lacks this kind of clear philosophical definition, whereas we can discuss subjectivity and objectivity in terms of the subject-object dichotomy. That's kind of been one, it's one of the oldest discussions in philosophy. It's much more difficult to pin down what people mean by consciousness. But I think it's all part of kind of healthy debate. AI, you mentioned these proponents of AI, these kind of tech gurus of our time who talk about AI and they talk about the singularity and they talk about where it's all heading. Consciousness is a bit of a diversion, not just for the reason I just mentioned that. It's very loosely defined, but it's become like the kind of currency for these AI gurus to kind of distract us from the kind of groundwork, foundational philosophical question of subjectivity.
Well, one of the things that seems very important to some of the AI proponents is, and it's the question of consciousness in terms of not just machine development or AI development, but transhumanism.
Yeah.
The idea being that our consciousness, yours and mine, is something beyond the body, something that doesn't, well, some people say it does outlive the body, some people say it doesn't or it cannot, but with some AI proponents, the idea is that your essential self in some way, your consciousness, could outlive your body in this world by being melded with some form of artificial, as I say, not natural technology. I know you point out in the book that technology is natural in the sense that it's, you know, constructed from components that have occurred naturally on the earth, or that we've synthesized yeah. with components that occur naturally on the earth, but there's still that consideration. So that's important in these terms. And of course, there's two major threads here, which are overlap, but they're not identical. And that's just the development of machine intelligence and AI. And then any interaction that we might have with that, and then beyond interaction, actually melding with, if you see what I mean, because for a lot of AI people, it's not just about artificial intelligence for its own sake, but it's very much about augmenting human intelligence and physicality and consciousness, moving beyond the human as we understand it.
The transhumanist movement and the kind of post-humanism and transhumanism, I think these are all very kind of interesting kind of scenarios, but they really divert our attention from what is much more significant. I think the most significant developments is that this sort of intelligent machinery is replacing human labor. And this has much more direct and present day social consequences than the notion of, I don't know, Elon Musk uploading himself into a computer or something very abstract. And I think a lot of these AI proponents are talking quite a lot of speculative and fashionable nonsense, really. I'm not a big fan of what they're saying in terms of, they're augmenting human intelligence. What we really need to do is to kind of bring the discussion back to what's happening in the here and now. They're looking for more investment. They're looking to expand their companies. What I think that I'm trying to do, and a lot of other people who are thinking about this subject right now, is see how this technology is affecting our world today. We don't need to be drawn even further away from reality with these transhumanists, these post-humanist thinking. If you are to augment a human being, and what would that entail? Having microchips planted in the brain? I mean, there are some examples of this happening, but what is happening for the majority of the population is this basic development of smart technology. You know, we don't have to go to cyborgs with biochip implants in their neuronal mechanisms in their brain to see cyborgs are basically walking around with their smartphones. I think it was Donna Haraway who said people. The kind of whole smartphone phenomenon is an example of the cyborg, the half human, half machine hybrid. So we don't really need to go to posthumanism. I think there's a lot of posthumanism, transhumanism, philosophically speaking, in terms of like the transcendental stuff. Again, these are all offshoots of the kind of postmodern way of thinking, where anything can be true, anything can happen.
I must admit, when I was reading your book, you know, as I say, you cover a lot of ground in quite a short space of time. And I moved from thinking feeling that you were pro certain technological developments and then very much cautious about others. So perhaps it would be good to ask you, what do you really feel in terms of technological development are the threats and promises? Because, you know, there's definitely optimism and pessimism, if I can put it like that, in your book. So I'd really like to know what you feel the core threats and promises are, because, you know, there are both absolutely in the things that are happening around us.
I think technology is a kind of, is like a double-sided coin. There's benefits and there are drawbacks. The threat to me is how technology is being used. Technology is when it's being used to create greater distance, separation between people, break down cohesive social units. That to me is the danger, and that goes for basically all technology. Anything that, because technology does create this gap or separation between ourselves, each other, the world. So I think the way that technology is being used today, this kind of the smart technology, is it's gone too far. I think there's too much of it. So I do think that it's a hazard, and I think it's created a very dangerous world. It's created a world, as I mentioned, a post-truth, and it's created a world where certain very kind of extreme views suddenly become part of the mainstream. People looking to reattach themselves to reality, and when a lot of kind of populists invective seems to kind of serve that purpose. So I think the currently the way the technology is being used, I'm not opposed to technology in general. We can't live without it, but the way that it's being used, the way our social sphere is becoming saturated, that is what I'm very opposed to, and at times quite emotively so.
And what's the promise, if you see what I mean? What does a good future? If we get to grips with some of these issues, then what does a good future look like in terms of technological development?
Well, I am an optimist, despite my diagnosis of the present day. I'm an optimist for the future, because a good future is where we really kind of harness the mechanical potential of this technology to enable us to live not just more comfortable lives, but I mentioned in the book, but even kind of one advantage of the machine is that it can inhabit very inhospitable environments. So for space exploration, I'm very optimistic about in the future. I think that machinery, robotics can serve a very good purpose. No, technology on the whole, I'm optimistic about technology if our approach to it is changed, if we have a much better understanding about how it's being used.
Can we say then that it's not, human beings certainly seem to have some kind of death drive. I don't mean all the time and across the board, but it's definitely part of us. You know, we seem to be our own worst enemies sometimes. But can we say then that you don't feel that there's an existential threat as things stand from developments in technology and AI to humankind, and we are still our own worst enemies?
I do think there, I wouldn't say there's necessarily existential threat in terms of extinction if we are to kind of reevaluate our approach to technology in terms of this kind of, there is a kind of death drive in becoming technologically saturated, in allowing ourselves to become technologically saturated and completely detached from the real world. What the real danger, the danger that is occurring today, is that we are continuing along this path without having, without a kind of a proper, without thought. There's not enough thought occurring, not enough human thinking occurring about where we are heading. Because, as I kind of described in this book, if we set out on this path of, I don't know, transhumanism, post-human, augmenting human beings, without understanding what that really means, then we do become, we literally become detached from the real world. And reality has a kind of habit of intruding when we least expect it. So it's all very well kind of the media talking about post-reality or post-truth. But this is a symptom of the kind of technological saturation that we're living through. So there is a danger there. There's a real danger there.
To go back again to the dystopian sci-fi that I grew up with, and, you know, which even a lot of those stories start out with the idea that machines, you know, we designed to make life less burdensome, to use that phrase from your book, right back from simple hand tools through to the technology that, you know, makes many of our lives in industrialized nations so comfortable today. The future that was projected, you know, of the leisure lifestyle and 3-day weeks and all the rest of it, seems to have turned instead into mass unemployment. I mean, also those people who are still working, many of them working harder than ever. So we have less and less jobs for people as mechanization takes those away, but simultaneously more and more people on the planet. And it does seem that, you know, there's no autonomous machine intelligence or action here making this happen. As they say, we're doing it to ourselves.
It doesn't kind of appear to be some sort of autonomous machine causing all this to happen. But again, appearances can be deceptive. If you include in this kind of calculation machine subjectivity, and one of the kind of very interesting short stories that I read was the one mentioned earlier by Ian Forster, The Machine Stops, how there could be like this grand amalgamation of all the technology in the world, all the silicon-based electronics, all the communications technology being a part of this great overarching machine. Now, I think that, and everybody following the mechanical imperative. So, as we've entered this kind of, this realm of technological psychosis, this detachment from reality, this post-truth realm, in the meantime, we're getting all our instructions, all the decision making from the kind of high-flying finance to the grassroots. All the decision making is following this technological imperative. It's all about technological efficiency. It's all, any problem that arises has a technological solution. So we are already and technology does have an autonomous development. Progress is measured by technological progress. I would really, if they haven't already, I'd recommend your listeners read this short story by Ian Forster, "The Machine Stops," where you do have a brief story about how this incredibly kind of dystopian future involves the development of this overarching machine, where progress, everyone can see progress and superstition has been put aside, and it's all because of what is described as the machine. And that is a kind of world that we're living in today. We're living in a world where humans are living in these kind of bubbles. Humans have been reduced to these kind of data points, where we are just kind of consumers serving the interests of this rapidly developing, rapidly advancing machinery.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, the machine stops is a great example of thought becoming reality, as it were. And you do have to wonder about how often we, you know, imagine these things, and just the very imagining, then someone else picks up on it, or whether the imagining is in itself the beginning, you know, like of something becoming reality. You know, everything, real thing begins with a thought, as it were. But it's such a great model for what's happening today. You mentioned a moment ago that reality has a way of interjecting, or, you know, rearing its head when we least expect it. And there was a great example of when the virtual and the real collide with the 2008 financial crisis, because a lot of what's happening, however chaotic, somehow feels a bit quite inevitable and if not smooth, it has a certain flow to it, we can take our hands off the steering wheel, as it were. And something like the 2008 financial crisis was very jarring. That showed us some of the potential problems that lie ahead of us, you know, if we don't consider these issues properly and act consciously in their development. And that's when the physical world that we, in this case of money, locks horns or smashes headlong into the virtual world. The difference between $1 billion and $1 million on a screen is a keystroke, and it, you know, there's nothing physical moves or changes or happens.
So the 2008 financial crisis that I mentioned in the book is very instructive, because at that stage the governments literally injected trillions of dollars and pounds into the financial system, and this was money that was kind of input into the system digitally. It had no relation to anything real and tangible in the physical world. And this, in a way, has postponed the crisis for another time. The next time there is a crisis, and there's sure to be one, again, we'll have this kind of another clash between the real and the virtual. At the time of around the time of the 2008 financial crisis, there was a lot of kind of possible emancipatory movements, such as the Occupy movement, the whole Arab Spring movement. There are a lot of social movements that suddenly awakened themselves. So the next time there is a crisis, there could be a new kind of social awakening. It could be the moment where people start to awaken from this slumber, where they realize that the machine has stopped. You know, there is going to be a moment where the machine stops. And that's the moment where people kind of awaken to what's happening. And the second book that I'm planning to write actually kind of picks up where the universal subject left off, and it's called The Red Pill. And it's about how we inhabit this kind of matrix of the machine. And it does take inspiration from The Matrix. And it talks about, and it'll be talking about, how the machine has become this kind of overarching organism, almost. People seem to be investing their trust into it more than each other. And technological saturation has led to the kind of problems that we're facing in the present day.
Okay, Darius, well, as we begin to bring things to a close for today, I'll just move to a few final thoughts. You talk about a reality check being required. I wonder what your thoughts are. This is not something that you really address in the book. Question of perhaps a resource reality check. That is to say, natural resources available to us on the Earth, some renewable, some non-renewable, out of which all our technology is constructed. A lot of technological developments if followed through logically, are kind of need to be predicated on almost infinite resources in a way, because we keep moving, things get bigger, more complex. All aspects of human society, everything from the food needed to feed the population through to rare earth metals needed for all sorts of very complex machines and technologies. We've already been running into hard limits and all sorts of resources. So I just wonder what your thoughts are on this issue, because, you know, utopian predictions by certain futurists, I feel, are going to be brought up rudely and rather short when they find out, oh, actually, we haven't got any more of this, or this particular resource has now become so expensive that it's prohibitively preventing us moving forward with the development of this technology. Or, you know, we have too many people now who cannot access this technology due to the expense of it.
The natural resource reality check is something that I think we all need to be thinking about. And a lot of these kind of AI proponents and these technology gurus, they do envision futures that and futurists envision futures where problems like this aren't really addressed. Energy crises could occur again. There could be another energy crisis like in the 1970s. For myself, for my book, I am an optimist. I am an optimist. So I do see us kind of overcoming any kind of challenges that might come our way, as long as we kind of invest ourselves in having renewed faith in the human, rather than in this kind of distancing technology. So if we do kind of start to wake up to the reality, start to take our destiny back into our own hands, then I don't see why difficulties that might arise from problems with natural resources can't be overcome.
Towards the end of your book, you raise some fascinating questions about other dimensions of human life, with, you know, the non-material questions about the soul and spirituality. And you talk about the role of religion in society. Religious stories are basically myths from a bygone age, but they help people interpret the world and to live in the past. And many people would say we need new myths for the present and for the future. And a lot of those will involve technology. It's interesting. You talk about, for example, the zeal of, the religious zeal of AI advocates and some futurists, and how Apple product launches, you know, look like, religious ceremonies. Yeah. And, you also consider, would it be perhaps new forms of spirituality that might emerge, as we move forward? You know, taking a positive view of the future, because certainly a dimension of life that seems that we can't really do without. We kind of try and pretend that we can. Everything can be purely materialist in terms of metaphysics, and also in terms of our daily lives. You know, just like, you know, that work and shopping and status and everything else is enough to satisfy us. It's not. Clearly we crave something beyond that. But also whether developments in technology might somehow open up for us new revelations about our purpose, perhaps. And we start to get into, again, you know, deep questions about meaning in life. And I think the centerpiece of universal advancement is a phrase from your book that you consider in terms of, you know, technology being part of evolution.
As you mentioned, I do talk about technology supplanting religion and new forms of spirituality emerging. Once we start to address, kind of think about the issues that are arising as a result of this whole kind of AI revolution, all forms of new thinking could emerge. So rather than clinging on to the old kind of dogmas of the kind of 20th century, the kind of very outmoded ways of thinking about religion, there could be a very new and exciting realms of human thought that could open up. Once we've kind of emancipated our thought, we turn our attention away from this technology. We take our eyes away from the smartphone. We suddenly wake up and realize that there's a real world out there. Then all sorts of new, as you might put it, revelations could occur. Now this is the kind of the in, all we could start talking about a universal advancement, as you mentioned. And this is the idea you have with the universal subject itself, and this is something that I describe in the book, is that this dialectic between man and machine, once recognized, the human and the mecha dialectic, once it's been appreciated, and we've suddenly detached ourselves from this over-reliance on technology, human thinking could reawaken. We could have a new age of the Enlightenment, even. A completion of the kind of a renewed enlightened age. There's so much kind of potential out there for human thought once we kind of take our attention away from this, from the smartphone, from these devices that are channeling our metabolic thinking activity into this kind of silicon realm. There, so much of human attention is now being diverted, is now being distracted into these kind of, into the internet, into these websites that really take our attention away from what's happening in the real world, that human thought isn't taking on, isn't realizing its full potential. So yeah, I do kind of see myself in a way as being a bit of a new ageist in terms of new forms of spirituality. I think there's just, I'm very excited about the times ahead. I think we live in a very exciting time.
Closing thought, Darius. Where my mind went early on when I was reading the first part of your book, you were talking about machine subjectivity, machine self-awareness. I wondered how much you were going to speculate about whether we somehow, in our the way we like to think about ourselves a lot of the time, are the be-all and end-all, or whether it might be at some point in the not-too-distant future, depending on developments of technology and AI, that we might have had our time, that maybe we aren't the omega of evolution on Earth or in the solar system or the galaxy or anywhere else.
My kind of realization as I was writing this book was that we may be having to share the planet with another emerging species, what I call the mechan or the mechanoid. This emerging form of consciousness isn't something that we might easily accept, in the same way that it took some time before we could accept that the Earth went around the Sun rather than vice versa. What we could be going through is another kind of scientific revolution in an age where we cannot imagine another scientific revolution. We've been through Darwin, Newton, the Enlightenment, relativity with Einstein. We now live at a point where we think all the questions have been answered. We have this idea of universal progress, but suddenly at the moment where you least expect it, our own kind of anthropocentrism could again be felled from a higher pedestal to a lower one, and we could realize that we are just one of two intelligent species on this planet.
Okay, Darius, well, today we've been discussing your book, The Universal Subject of Our Time, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Machine. That's available everywhere. Readers can find it on Amazon, all the usual outlets. Before we go, is there anything you'd like to share with listeners? You mentioned a book that you're working on, a follow-up. Have you got a website, blog, anything at all you'd like to put out there?
Yep, thank you very much for having me on your show, Greg. Yes, the book is called The Universal Subjects of Our Time, and the second book I'm planning is called The Red Pill. Thanks very much for having me on the show.